Yeah. Welcome back to the Gridiron Expert. Tom Allen is winning at a basketball school. And I don't think people understand how difficult and how impressive that really is. Allen led Indiana to their first bowl appearance since 2016 last year. But even more impressive, for the first time in 26 years, Indiana captured an 8-win season. And it was nearly a 9-win season, as the Hoosiers finished 8-5, losing a heartbreaker to Tennessee in the Gator Bowl, 23-22. But all that is in the past. It's in the rearview mirror. Indiana is looking forward, and rightfully so, as they have what could be perhaps one of the best and most athletic teams in Indiana football history. They returned 17 starters from last year's historic squad. And we'll start on the offense here, as they return 8 starters from an offense that averaged 31.8 points per game. While offensive coordinator Kalen DeBoer does leave to go take the job at Fresno State, I do not think that's going to play as big of a role and as big of an impact on this Indiana offense. Michael Penix is back at quarterback, and if he can stay healthy, he's going to be very dangerous for opposing Big Ten defenses. Stevie Scott III is back at running back, had 845 yards on the ground last year with 10 touchdowns. Their leading wide receiver, WR Whop Philyor, is back, had 1,002 receiving yards and 5 touchdowns last year. This offense is stacked. Only minor concern is on the offensive line, one that I think will continue to get better every single week. Defensively, Indiana returns 9 starters from a unit that only gave up 24.4 points per game last year. They are set at every position, defensive line, linebackers, and in the secondary. They're going to be led by Micah McFadden, who led the team with 61 tackles last year, and Jerome Johnson, who led the team with 5 sacks last year. It's one of the best teams we may have ever seen from Indiana football, and I guarantee you Tom Allen is going to take advantage of it. And we break down their schedule here. The first thing you should look at is look at this half of the schedule and look at their final 5 games. If Indiana wants to complete yet another historic season, if they want to get back to the postseason, they're going to have to capitalize off of what is a very favorable first 7 games of the year. We begin here with Wisconsin. That's not one of the favorable games. It really is the 6 after that. They open up the season right in the middle of Big Ten play on a Friday night at Camp Randall Stadium. Wisconsin, of course, loses Jonathan Taylor. Fantastic running back, had over 2,000 all-purpose yards last year. Their second leading rusher last year was Nakia Watson, who only had 331 yards on the ground. So Wisconsin has a major shoe to fill there. But what they don't have to worry about is their defense that returns 9 starters and a veteran quarterback in Jack Cohn, who to me, as a first-year starter last year, played extremely well. I think Indiana fight valiantly in this game. But ultimately, Wisconsin's defense, which was 4th in total defense last year, is going to be the difference maker. They rarely lose at Camp Randall Stadium, and I certainly don't see them losing the season opener. Indiana starts 0-1. They put up some points on this team, but they do start 0-1 in Big Ten Conference play and on the season. Then things pick up. Don't overlook Western Kentucky, a team that went 9-4 last year, a team that went on the road and annihilated Arkansas, a team that averaged 128.5 rushing yards per game last year with Gage Walker, going up against an Indiana rushing defense that gave up 138.5 rushing yards per game. This is a Western Kentucky team that could give the Hoosiers a fight, at least for a half. But I do think ultimately the Hoosiers do pull away. They get a win over the Hilltoppers. I do believe they get a win over Ball State. And I do believe they get a win over UConn as well, now of the independents, moving from the American Athletic Conference and becoming an independent. So just like that, they get 3 wins in the non-conference, as you would expect. They're 3-1 going into their bye week, going into the bulk of Big Ten Conference play. They hit Maryland on October 10th, off of a week of rest. They beat the Terrapins 34-28 last year. That was just one of two one-possession losses for Maryland in the midst of that seven-game losing streak to conclude their 3-9 season. I think Mike Loxley gets his team back on track in 2020. I'm not saying they're going to go bowling, but I do think they're more competitive. You'll see more one-possession games. And if the chips fall the right way, they might be able to win some of those games. But off a week of rest, at home, Indiana's not losing to what will still be a struggling Terrapin squad. They get a win here, back to 500 in Big Ten Conference play, and we do believe they get a win on the road at Rutgers. Indiana defeated the Scarlet Knights 35-0 last year, marking one of four times that Rutgers was shut out in 2019. Greg Schiano will turn this program around, but with an ever-improving Big Ten, at schools like Indiana, potentially Maryland in a few years, the work is just going to be that much harder for them. They get back home to face off against Michigan State, a game that Indiana could have won last year. If you go back and look at the score, it's 40-31. Michigan State won that game. And you say, that's a 9-point game. They didn't almost win. Watch the entire game and you'll realize the last-ditch effort by Indiana resulted in a touchdown for the Spartans. The Hoosiers tied the game at 31 with 2 minutes left before Michigan State went down there, kicked a game-winning field goal, and then, of course, got that late touchdown to really seal the deal. It was much closer than it appeared. Michigan State is not going to be nearly as good as they were last year, and they weren't even all that great last year, averaging just 22.4 points per game. They have Mel Tucker now, brand new head coach from Colorado, because Mark D'Antonio left them high and dry by resigning in the middle of February. They have questions at the quarterback position. The only strength that Michigan State might have going for them is their defense, which was the only really good bright spot last year, and a very strong offensive line. This game is at home. Indiana usually plays well against the Spartans, and with so much uncertainty coming out of East Lansing, I don't see them coming to take on and to get a win on the road against a very talented Hoosier squad. Indiana has now won 6 straight games. So bingo, they're going bowling yet again. Back-to-back years, Tom Allen has gotten the Hoosiers to the postseason, sitting at 6-1. At this point, even though the strength of schedule is not great, the Hoosiers are more than likely a top 25 team. And you have to start taking them seriously as a potential threat in the Big Ten East, considering they do get to host Penn State on Halloween. But as we mentioned, the first 7 games are relatively easy, with the exception of that Wisconsin game to open up the year. The back 5 against arguably the top 3 teams in the Big Ten East, Penn State, Ohio State, and Michigan, makes things a lot more difficult, to the point where a 6-1 start could quickly turn into a 6-6 finish. On Halloween against Penn State, Indiana put up 462 yards of offense against that Nittany Lions defense last year. And that was in Happy Valley, as the Hoosiers only lost to them 34-27. This is a potential trap game for the Nittany Lions. This is a potential huge upset win for the Hoosiers. Because what you don't see here is that the week before, October 24th, Penn State takes on Ohio State. And Penn State usually has a hangover when they lose to Ohio State. And if that is the case this year, coming into a hostile Indiana team on the road that's hungry for a quality win, that's 6-1 and has their eyes set on a potential East crown if things go their way, Penn State cannot afford to overlook them. I do not think James Franklin allows that to happen. I think this game is very similar to the one we saw last year, a touchdown or less, but this time it's still in favor of the Nittany Lions. They avoid a huge scare on the road to Indiana, and the Hoosiers take their loss here. Sean Clifford and that dynamic rushing duo of Journey Brown and Noah Cain will ultimately be too much. They then, of course, lose to Ohio State. We have the Buckeyes going 12-0. We don't see anybody beating Ohio State in the regular season. Justin Fields, Trey Sermon, Chris Olave, Garrett Wilson, all that offensively going up against the Indiana defense, it's going to be good, but not good enough to shut down that electric of an offense. They then return home to face off against Illinois. So the schedule lightens up a little bit. 2 of their final 3 are at home, And two of their final three are certainly winnable at home against Purdue and Illinois. Now, the Fighting Illini could be a sneaky good team in the Big Ten this year. 9 returning starters offensively from a unit that went 6-7 last year, finally making a bowl game under Lovie Smith. But when you look at their schedule, the Fighting Illini are going to get run down. They're going to get run down quick. The defense is my only cause of concern for them. And with what is going to be a very, very good Indiana offense, one that I do think will continue to average over 30 points per game, I don't think the Fighting Illini have enough to come on the road and get the win. So Indiana gets back in the win column, clinches their 7th win of the year. They just need one more to match last year's win total, and that's fortunately not going to come against Michigan. It's not going to come on the road at the Big House. They lost 39-14 at home last year to the Wolverines. And Michigan's a team that Indiana has given up fights against in recent years. They've really challenged the Wolverines at times. And I think many thought that last year, Indiana might be able to pull off the upset or at least take them down to the wire like we've seen them do multiple years in a row. They were unable to do that, getting annihilated. And this Michigan team might even be better than the one we saw last year, especially if they start getting good and consistent quarterback play out of what we believe will be Dylan McCaffrey. We give Michigan the win here at home, and Indiana rounds out the season in the battle for the old Oaken Bucket, a series where the last 4 games have been decided by one possession. That includes last year's 44-41 victory in double overtime for the Hoosiers to clinch their 8th win of the season. If Purdue is healthy, you could see this game be very, very close yet again. 5th straight year, you'll see it decided by one possession. Jack Plummer throwing to speedy wide receivers like David Bell and Rondale Moore, and a defense that should certainly improve. Purdue was battled by injuries last year. Odds are it's not going to happen again. But odds are that at Indiana, with the chance to win their 8th game for the 2nd year in a row, the Hoosiers aren't going to afford to lose that game. They're not going to allow themselves to lose that game. And I do believe Indiana gets the win over their rival in the Boilermakers. And with that win in the season finale, we have Indiana finishing 8-4 for the 2nd straight year in a row. So for the first time in 1 year, Indiana will capture yet another 8-win season. Unbelievable job that Tom Allen is doing with the Hoosiers. But here's the kicker. Here's the thing that's even better. 8-4, Indiana will find themselves in a relatively decent bowl game yet again. And if they win that game, the Hoosiers will clinch their first 9-win season since 1967. So guys, thank you so much for watching us here at The Gridiron Expert. Please continue to like, comment, and subscribe, and check out everything we have for you down in the description below. I can promise you, you do not want to miss it. And once again, as always, thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you next time right here on The Gridiron Expert.